Hi everyone, in this video I'm going to explain the Unified Namespace, or UNS in short. It's a concept which has been around for a while, but it's getting quite some traction right now. So I'll talk about the concept, but more importantly, I'm also going to share some of my personal experiences with you. Yeah, and me, that's David. I worked in the chemical industry for 12 years as an end user. Today, I'm managing analytics for industry, which is an IT-OT solution provider. That's my day job. And next to that, I'm also writing the IT-OT insider. In my day job with analytics for industry, I'm working more with food and beverage customers, critical infrastructure, that type of verticals. With the IT-OT insider, I'm getting exposed to all kinds of sectors all over the world, both from an end user perspective as well as from a technology provider perspective. So that's really cool. Gives me some nice insights. Okay, first things first. The Unified Namespace is not a product you can sell off the shelf. It's a concept. You should think of it as an aspirational state, something you want to achieve when building your operational data platform. But what is it? And do you need one? So think about it. You have machines, sensors, databases, ERP systems. They are all generating tons and tons of data, but often in silos. It's hard to make sense of it and turn it into something useful. So for example, predictive maintenance. It's difficult because technicians are wasting time digging through Excel sheets. AI projects, they fail not because of the lack of algorithms, but because the data isn't well organized. And if you want to build a data-driven organization, you need to have fast, secure, and contextual access to your data across all applications. Now, instead of reinventing the wheel for every data use case, we want to invest in a data platform. Not just throw your data into one big data lake, which soon will become a data swamp if you're not careful, but in a structured operational data platform, which is built to work with manufacturing, sensor, IIoT data. But what does it mean to work with sensor data? So first of all, we obviously talk about time series data. What is time series data? Can be data which flows in at very fast rates, maybe at very slow rates, might be 100,000, 10,000, 100,000 sensors or even more. The scale doesn't really matter, but it's how your time series data looks like, because the data flows in when it flows in, which means that in order to be able to work with that time series data in applications further along the line, for example, if you want to download that into an Excel sheet, if you want to have that in your Power BI report, in a Python script or whatever, you also want to interpolate that data at scale. And this is where it becomes a little bit more tricky. Now, storing time series data, something which you can do with a lot of platforms. More importantly is also adding a contextualization layer, understanding the manufacturing, the process, the infrastructure context. Understanding context means understanding the physical assets, understanding the production line, understanding how the car looks like, how the water distribution network looks like, what assets are there, what is the role of those assets. What data points do these assets have? Understanding the production context, what batch is running, what operator was working, what product were we making, etc., etc. And of course, you also want to work around data quality, because garbage in, it's garbage out. And working with data quality is something else in the sensor world compared to the IT world, because it's harder to get a baseline. When is data correct? So, as I already said in the beginning, the Unified Namespace, UNS, is a design pattern. It's not a product. The concept around the UNS is there to help you organize that data into an operational data platform. So first things first, let's start with a short definition. What is a UNS? A Unified Namespace, at least in my understanding, is an organized and centralized data broker depicting data in context from your entire business, so not only from one line or from one silo, but potentially from your entire business, as it is right now. So real-time insights. So let's go through these 3 points one by one. So first one was context, organization. So your data wants you want your data to be organized, and that means that your data is structured, typically following models like ISO 95, which reflects the actual hierarchy of your business. This could be a plant, a production line, or even up to a specific machine. Besides the organization, you also want to have context going alongside with your sensor data. You want to have an easy way to find out what product was getting produced, maintenance actions were taken, maybe even the quality of test samples which got checked in the lab. And you want to be able to overlay all these types of context on top of your sensor data. And in the applications who I would say are consuming that data, you want to have an easy way to extract that context alongside with your sensor data. For example, give me the temperature profile of that batch, or let's say, give me the average steam production over my last 100 CIP cleaning in place rounds I did in my manufacturing line, or whatever. So you want to have that context be readily available for everybody to use. And that's something what I see personally as one of the main barriers when you're executing data-driven projects, is that if you do not have that context readily available, it can take quite a while, and up to, I typically see up to 50, 60, 70, 80% of the time somebody needs to, I would say, execute a data-driven project typically goes to finding the data, contextualizing the data, and then finally also cleaning the data. All right, and then the third point is real time. So a unified namespace shows you what is happening right now across potentially the entire organization. So no outdated reports, no waiting around, instant access to your latest data. But there are some challenges as well to point out. First of all, organizing data doesn't just happen. You still need to model it. Yes, of course, building templates can get you far, but still, somebody needs to build the templates. And also, what is your perfect model? Who describes that? Also, who decides that? Who says that your template should consist of point 1, 2, 3, or 4? Do you now need data stewards? Do you need to build data communities, data owners? It's a bit tricky. And this is all, I would say, to do with data governance. Now, in any case, I personally prefer to use to start with a use case based approach, where you don't try to build the perfect data model or the one source of truth. You start from a use case based perspective or a use case based approach, where you say, okay, I'm having this problem right now. For example, I want to bring in, I'm doing a predictive maintenance thing. I have a centralized maintenance department somewhere. Okay, let's build a namespace where we bring in all the large rotating equipments, all the pumps, all the heat exchangers, whatever we need for that specific maintenance use case, for example. Another use case might be an energy use case where you're bringing in energy data. And the interesting thing is that actually might end up with multiple models, multiple namespaces coexisting, and that's perfectly fine. I've seen a lot of efforts fail when we try to build that one source of truth, because everybody with a specific role in the organization will look at their reality, and that might be different. So that's challenge number one. Another challenge is storing your data. And I'm not just meaning the accessing the real time, the now data, but you also wanna be able to go back to the history. Yeah? You wanna somehow access what happened in the past, for example, to build an energy profile, to calculate your historical OEE numbers or whatever. Now, that means that you still need a way to store your data as well. Eh? So the unified namespace as a basic concept is a broker which gives you the data as it is right now. Now, you could either have an application who subscribes to the unified namespace and I would say constantly gets the new data and stores it in some way or form. Or you could, I would say, apply some kind of a hybrid approach where you're still storing your data in more a traditional data historian, but at the same time also making it available for other applications, or even making the unified namespace available on top of your data historian. So multiple solutions can exist here. So you might go for the more, I would say, traditional OT approach. Nothing wrong with that, because these historians, they do quite a lot of things out of the box for you. You could go for a cloud native solution and maybe offered by one of the hyperscalers. There are so many startups as well available in this domain. You might go for a dedicated IoT platform, or, and I think that's the most likely solution, you probably end up with some kind of a hybrid architecture where you want to have your data locally available at your SCADA level, at your MES level, to do local control, maybe have your operators work on it some way, in some way or form, locally, either with the built-in tools or with additional tools. But on the, I would say, the same time, you also want to enable the more data science driven use cases. You want to enable data sharing. You want to expose your data to new solutions. Maybe you want to bring in your data into your enterprise BI tooling, et cetera, et cetera. So that means that you will most likely, at least today, end up with a hybrid solution where you have edge components, where you have more, I would say, traditional SCADA components, where you will have more the cloud native components working working in harmony in the best possible way. And then besides the, I would say, the storage format, you also need to decide, okay, how am I going to store my data? Am I going to store raw data, clean data, validated data, or all three? And this is also where I would say the medallion architecture or the Delta Lake architecture comes into play. So we see that, I would say, especially in the Delta Lake architecture, and we see that we are typically tiering our data in three levels. The bronze layer, where we store raw data, so just the data as it comes in. If it's faulty, it's faulty. If it's noisy, it's noisy. It doesn't really matter, but we store it as it comes in. And then one step further, we have the silver layer, where we store cleaned data, maybe validated data, especially in industries where validation is, where you have validation requirements, pharma, food, others as well. Clean data means that you also need a way to, I would say, clean time series data at scale. That's also a challenge on its own. And then finally, you also have the gold layer, where you basically store prepared data sets. Prepared data sets mean data sets ready to be used, ready for analysis. The ones you load into your report, the ones you send to whatever endpoint you want to send them to, but they are prepared, they are validated, they are contextualized, they are versioned in some cases. You could compare it a little bit with the data warehouse found and still find in IT environments. But here as well, again, I prefer not to make things too complex, not to invent the wheel over and over and over again. From an IT perspective, it's really important to understand that you can't just start building these things from scratch, and you really want the expertise we've been developing in the OT world for decades to give you that kickstart. So in general, I would say if there is an existing foundation, yeah, build upon it. If you have OPC, you do not need to replace it by MQTT. If you have an historian, you don't need to replace that by a system running somewhere in the cloud or whatever. Now, you still might want to replace it if it doesn't work like you expect it to work, or is it maybe it's too expensive or whatever, but you don't need to change whatever you already have right now. What I would say is take the components you have and look at them from a capability point of view. Do they help you achieving that data platform vision? Do they help you implement such a data model, such a namespace? Are you able to build this maybe a hybrid solution, edge to cloud solution, where you can have multiple components working in hierarchy? And I think that's the most important starting points. It's the same a bit with the Delta Lake concept. I suppose you're using Databricks, for example, to process your data on the IT cloud side. Do not start directly by ingesting all possible data you have. No, let's make it use case driven, not technology driven. Now, if you, of course, are lucky to be starting from some kind of a greenfield approach, or you don't have any components yet, yeah, well, you could say it's different ball game. Well, in essence, it's still the same ball game. You want to be very, very agile. You don't want to solve everything at the same time. But of course, the big difference here is that you can choose for the newest possible technologies on the market. Now, take in mind that this is a market which is changing at lightning speeds. You see new companies starting every week. You see the existing companies changing I'm not able to catch up, I would say, with all the technology changes which are coming in right now. So that means that if you make a decision right now to go for a certain platform, make sure that you have your 1-3 year vision, I would say, at the back of your minds, but don't try to build everything at once. Be very, very agile. You want to be as agile as you can, given your context. You want to be use case driven. You want to be outcome driven, but you definitely do not want to be technology driven in these types of projects. So, is the unified namespace the solution for all your data integration, data sharing problems? No. It's a very good concept. You can actually build your vision around such a concept, but it's not a solution on its own. It's a way to get you started, a way to think about how you will make data available in a centralized way to all data users and to all applications. If you found this video helpful, make sure to hit the like and subscribe button for the channel, because more content will follow soon. Find our blog at itotinsider.com. Thanks for watching and see you soon.